Hello, everybody. This is Brother Luke, Sin City Preacher. Welcome to this episode of Bible Talk with Brother Luke. Today, I'm continuing the study of the book of Acts, and I'm going to begin with chapter 19, verse 1. If you have not seen the previous studies on Acts, those videos are uploaded and available on my YouTube channel, Sin City Preacher. I hope you will go back and watch this from the very beginning. Let me start off by making sure you see my shirt here. It says, let me see, get that centered. It's hard, everything's backwards. Okay. Jesus, the one and only way to get to heaven. Put your faith in him. All right, so I'm a KJV firstist, so let me read it first in the KJV. I may also look at it in the Amplified if I think it might be helpful. Acts chapter 19. Oops, glasses. Are dirty. Some of you might have wondered why it's been a gap in time between my videos. I haven't been well lately, and it's been some health issues I'm dealing with. I feel like I'm getting better. My mind is not quite as sharp as I'd like it to be right now. I'm hoping I can get through this and actually make some sense. But I'm on my way to recovery, I think, though. So let's begin chapter 19, verse 1. And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coasts, came to Ephesus. And finding certain disciples, he said unto them, Have ye received the Holy Ghost since ye believed? And they said unto him, We have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. And he said unto them, Unto what then were ye baptized? And they said, Unto John's baptism. Then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that ye should believe on him which should come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. So, it seems to me that they were baptized by John before Jesus was identified, perhaps, we've been telling you that the Messiah is coming, and they got baptized, but that was before the Messiah actually came. Before Jesus began his ministry with his baptism by John, too. So perhaps these people were baptized back then, and that's what it means by John's baptism, because Paul is saying John's baptism is to believe in Jesus. He says, then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance. That means to change your mind and have a new belief system. You have faith in the Messiah that's coming, that there's a promised Messiah. Well, now we want you to believe now that the Messiah has come. Saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus. So now they were told to put their faith in the coming Messiah, and Paul's here to tell them that, okay, the promised Messiah has come. It is Jesus Christ. So Paul is here, he's in his first missionary journey. This is approximately 20 years after Pentecost. This is about 10 years after the Apostle Peter was given the mission to preach to Cornelius and his family, the first Gentile believers. So it's 20 years after Gentiles were accepted as believers. And as I said many times in the study before, it was not easy for the church in the beginning, which was all Jewish people, to accept the fact that Gentiles were going to be part of this, and that the Messiah, the Savior, came not just for the Jews, but also for the Gentiles. It was hard for them to accept that. The Jewish people were very prejudiced. It was a very segregated, prejudiced society. Jewish people did not associate with Gentiles in any way. So there was quite a stir when Peter preached to the Gentiles, and the Gentiles believed. And there was, and then the next argument was, well, what about circumcision? What about the laws of Moses? And the Jewish believers, they didn't understand that Judaism served its purpose, and now it needs to be discarded. We cannot put our faith in things like circumcision and the laws of Moses, temple worship, animal sacrifices. Those things played their part, but now there's no more role for them to play. We need to discard all that. And these are the things that are taught as we study Acts, and then look at also the books of Romans, Galatians, and Hebrews. We learn all that not only were they astonished that Gentiles are included, but they're also astonished that all the practices of Judaism should be discarded. So Paul is on this missionary journey. He's traveled all around, and now he says, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus. And of course, Ephesus is a city where this church that he establishes here, Paul is a missionary and evangelist more than he is a pastor. He's traveling. He's like a traveling evangelist who, you know, how in American history they would put up a big tent and have these tent revivals, and evangelists would preach the gospel, people would be saved, and then the evangelists would move on to another city. The evangelists did not stay there and serve as their pastor. So that's what Paul did. But when he started the church, he would also want to stay in communication with them, and through his letters, these are called epistles, the epistles that Paul wrote were called the Pauline epistles. Romans through Philemon are normally the ones that are considered Paul's letters. I happen to believe that the book of Hebrews is also Paul's letter, Paul's writing. It's another one of Paul's letters, but it was written to just all the Jewish believers, because the Jewish believers that are addressed in the book of Hebrews are their problem is that they believed in Jesus, but they're still doing temple worship and animal sacrifices. So that's the main point of the book of Hebrews, to say, look, you need to stop that. It served its purpose. Don't insult Jesus' finished work by thinking that more is needed, more is required, like temple worship and animal sacrifices and the law of Moses. So here Paul is in Ephesus, preaching to them, and as I said, later he'll be writing a letter to the people in Ephesus, to the believers there. So it says that they haven't received the Holy Spirit because they never put their faith in this person. See, you had to put your faith not only in the Messiah, but you had to know who he was. It was Jesus. So, and what a lot of people think is critical to understand the Bible is called dispensationalism. But they think that dispensationalism means that a dispensation is a period of time where God set up a certain set of rules for people to follow, and that was the during that dispensation, which they think is a period of time, those rules were in fact, that's the way God was dealing with people, and then the next period of time, God changes the rules or changes the way he's dealing with the people in a way, so you have a new dispensation. But dispensation is not a period of time. Dispensation just means like if I have a Pez dispenser and I press on it, a little Pez comes out, and I give you one, and then I press it and give another one. I'm dispensing the Pez candies to people. So dispensing means to, dispensation, it comes from the root word dispense, and it means to pass out, to give something to someone. And what was dispensed was more information from God about who he was and the promised Messiah and the means of salvation. So over time, gradually, people began to understand more and more because God revealed more and more. But it's not a different set of rules, different means of salvation, as some people teach. Salvation was always based from the very beginning, from the fall of Adam until the end of time. The salvation has always been based upon the grace of God and faith in him for salvation. Salvation was never achieved through any kind of religious works. It was always because God was gracious, not because we deserved it and earned it through works. And then that was God's part. God's part is grace. And that's why in Ephesians 2, 8, 9, it says, "For by grace are we saved through faith. And that not of itself is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast." So we see in this these verses in Ephesians that it says there's two parts here. God's part is grace. God is being gracious, giving us something that we don't deserve, salvation. And man's part is faith. We receive this salvation because God is gracious, but only if we put our faith. The means of salvation is through faith. Faith must be, though, in the right thing. And that the thing that we have to believe in is the person and finished work of Jesus Christ. So now we understand it perfectly because we look back at the Bible in hindsight and we can understand it much better than the people who were receiving prophecies over the period of thousands of years, and more was revealed. They didn't understand it as well as we can today. So at this time, the people, John told them to believe in the Messiah that was to come, but they didn't know who he was. He hadn't been revealed yet. And Paul is telling them, now I'm revealing to you more. I'm dispensing more critical information for you. It's not just believing in the Messiah to come. He's come. Now you must believe that he has come in the person of Jesus Christ. Now, let me see. Verse 5, when they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Verse 6, and when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied. So at this time in church history, it was typical that when people believed in Jesus, there was a sign that everybody could see. It was evident to everybody that there was a true salvific faith from these people, and the Holy Spirit came on them, and they would speak in tongues, and this was the evidence that there was a true conversion. But as Paul says later in his letters, he talks about various gifts, and he says that tongues shall cease. And so I believe that tongues and also all the signs and wonders that we see in these throughout the book of Acts, these things do cease. And rather than putting our having signs and wonders and tongues and stuff as evidence to make us believe or to help us believe, now, our faith must be real pure faith, because we don't have the miracles that the apostles did and that Jesus did to say, oh, he proved his case. Look at the miracles he's done. We don't have that. We have a history of it, but we don't have anything like that going on today to confirm our faith. So our faith is more pure today. As I made a video, Faith, the One Requirement, and in that video, I make the point of saying that our faith is even a greater faith than, for example, Paul. Jesus appeared to him. He showed himself. The apostle Thomas, we call him Doubting Thomas, he didn't believe Jesus was resurrected until Jesus appeared to him and he touched him. And Jesus said, blessed are you those who have not seen and yet believe. The Bible says without faith it is impossible to please God, and it says that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And it says that we walk by faith, not by sight. So today, we don't get to see Jesus and touch him and observe all these miracles that we saw from Jesus and in early church history. Now, God just expects us just to believe him because that's what it says in the scriptures. And so that's the reason for these tongues here. Verse 7, and the men, and all the men were about 12. So there were 12 people who the Holy Spirit came on them. They believed that not only the Messiah came, but it was this Messiah is Jesus, and that they were the Holy Spirit came on them, so they were baptized with the Holy Spirit, indwelled with the Holy Spirit, sealed with the Holy Spirit unto the day of redemption, and they spoke in tongues, and that was a sign that convinced Paul. And that would convince anybody at that time that hey, there's a real conversion here. Verse 8, and he went into the synagogue and spake boldly for the space of 3 months. So you see, Paul, I think in the last chapter or two, he kind of was fed up and says, I'm giving up on you Jews. I'm just going to talk to Gentiles. But still, each city he goes into, he can't really give up on them. He continues going to the synagogue and preaching to the Jews. His love for the Jewish people never stops, and he continues, even though he's called the apostle to the Gentiles, the first apostle to the Gentiles, and if we want to go just in chronological order, the first one to preach to Gentiles was Peter. And Peter did preach exactly the same message as Paul. All through this book of Acts study, we see the messages word for word of what Peter preached, and it was the death, burial, and resurrection and faith in Jesus for salvation. And so, and that was the same message that Paul preached. So the hyper-dispensationalists, the Paul-onlyists, they want to tell you that only Paul preached the true message of salvation, that the gospel, the grace of God. They don't know what they're talking about. I have a playlist that debunks every aspect of Paul-onlyism. It's called Paul-onlyism Debunked. I hope you will watch that if you're caught up in this heresy of Paul-onlyism. So it says, and when he went into the synagogue, he spake boldly for the space of 3 months, disputing and persuading the things concerning the kingdom of God. So he would go through the scriptures, all through the Old Testament, all of the prophecies about the Messiah, the things that he would suffer, the death, burial, and resurrection that was prophesied in the Old Testament, and say these things are all fulfilled. That was Paul's message when he would go into the synagogue. Verse 9, but when divers were hardened, I don't know how that makes any sense to me, but when divers were hardened, and believe not. Okay, diverse, so variety of people were hardened and believe not. But spake evil of that before the multitude, he departed from them and separated the disciples, disputing daily in the school of one Tyrannus. So when it says, but when the diverse were hardened and believed not, we find that every time Paul went to the synagogue, he got basically three responses. Some people would believe and they're happy and they want to know more. Other people would not believe and they just totally rejected Paul's message. And other people not only did not believe, but would stone Paul or attempt to stone him. So those are basically the three reactions that Paul got when he went to the synagogues. But in this case, 12 people believed. And but it says when diverse were hardened, believe not, they spake evil, and so Paul departed, and he separated the disciples, disputing daily in the school of one Tyrannus. Tyrannus, it sounds like that's from the word tyrant. That's, I wonder who Tyrannus was. It doesn't tell us much about him, I don't think. Let me read this in the Amplified. It says, Paul left them, taking the disciples with him, and went on holding daily discussions in the lecture hall of Tyrannus instead of the synagogue. Okay, so this says it's the hall of Tyrannus. Let me see the footnote on that. And that was... verse 9. One Greek manuscript says Paul used the lecture hall from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. Okay, but it's a lecture hall called Tyrannus, I guess. It's not a person. It sounded to me like in the KJV, this was Tyrannus was a person. Maybe it was named after a person named Tyrannus. So it says, disputing daily in the school of one Tyrannus. Verse 10, and this continued by the space of 2 years, so that all which were, they which dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks. So I believe he's still in Ephesus, but maybe a just different part of the town here. It doesn't say that he went to another city. Usually when he departs a city, it tells you he went to another city. So I think this is still in Ephesus, so for this 2 year period. And at verse 11, and God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. So we're still in a time where signs and wonders were performed by the apostles, and this was a means of confirming that they are legitimate representatives of God, and that their message is true. Verse 13, then certain of the vagabond Jews, exorcists, took upon them to call over them which had evil spirits the name of the Lord Jesus, saying, we adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preacheth. And there were 7 sons of one Sceva, a Jew, and a chief of the priests which did so. And the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are ye? And the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on them and overcame them and prevailed against them, so that they fled out of that house naked and wounded. Oh, man. Yeah. So it seems to me that the demons, in James it says the demons believe and yet they tremble. So demons can believe and they know about God. They know about Jesus. They're aware of all these things. They even, in this case, it says they're even aware of Paul. And we know who Paul is. But them believing that these things are true, of course, doesn't save a demon. As far as we know from scriptures, there is no salvation for demons, unless there is that is that's not recorded. But I think we can assume that there's no salvation for demons. And so even though they believe all these things, they know the facts, they got all their facts right, they can't be saved. And it's just like a person who believes in all the facts about Jesus. Like they believe he's the Son of God. They believe the death, burial, and resurrection. They believe he died for our sins. And yet they never put their faith in those facts for their salvation. They don't get saved, even though they have mental assent to the fact that, oh yeah, we believe all that. This is typical of the Roman Catholics. Ask any Roman Catholic. Do you believe that Jesus died for our sin? He was buried and raised from the dead on the third day. And they say, of course I believe that. I'm Roman Catholic. Then ask them, well, do you think you're going to go to heaven and why? And they say, well, I might go to heaven. I think I might because I'm a good person and I go to church and I go to confession and communion and so on. They put their faith in salvation as the means of it is religious works, personal merit. Their faith is never in the finished work of Jesus, even though they believe he died for our sins. So there's a great distinction that we need to understand there. And in this case, these people, they were preaching Jesus, but the demon didn't respect them. He was not intimidated in any way. Of course, if Jesus had been speaking to them or Paul had been speaking to them, I get the impression that they would certainly cower because Jesus had the authority, Paul had the authority, but these people didn't have any kind of authority. Perhaps they never really believed in Jesus, even though they were trying to cast out demons in his name. So the demon prevailed against them, and they fled out of that house naked and wounded. Verse 17, and this was known to all the Jews and Greeks also dwelling at Ephesus, and fear fell on them all, and the name of Lord Jesus was magnified. That's verse 17. I think that's a good place for me to stop today. I'll pick this up with verse 18 next time. So thank you for watching, and I'll do these studies as often as I can. As I said, there's been a little delay since my last one, and hopefully we'll work our way through the book of Acts, and then my plan is to go through all the epistles, and we'll go through these scriptures verse by verse and give you my thoughts on them. So thank you for watching. If you've never put your faith in Jesus, please do it now. You need to just accept that Jesus is, as the shirt says, the only way. Ooh, it's hard to get it straight. Jesus is the only way to heaven. What does that mean? It means that if God judged you and said, why should I let you into heaven? You cannot plead anything like, well, I'm a good person, or I got circumcised, or I followed the laws of Moses, or I followed the Ten Commandments, I followed the golden rule, I. If you're pleading your case to God, that your salvation should be granted to you based upon your performance, your personal merit, you'll be rejected. Because the Bible says we're not saved by our works, we're saved by our faith in Jesus. So reject that and instead put your faith in Jesus entirely. Salvation comes by faith alone, no religious works, but the faith alone must be in Christ alone. The five solas of the Reformation are sola scriptura, is that we believe in the doctrines from the Bible and nothing else. We do not believe in the teachings of men, but the scriptures, sola scriptura. There's another sola, is sola gratia, that we're not saved by any works, but anything that, any kind of personal merit. We're saved only because God is gracious, only because of the grace of God, sola gratia. And then there's sola fide. That means we're saved not by our own efforts, but our faith in faith, and entirely not by what we've done, but our faith. And then solus Christo means our faith must be only in Christ. We cannot divide our faith between Christ and any religious works on our part. Otherwise, the Bible says if we divide it, it's nullified, it's canceled, it's frustrated, and it's of no effect. And then sola Gloria means that only if you do all these things, if you understand and believe in this way, only in that way does the glory go entirely to God. You cannot claim any glory. You cannot boast at all if you base your salvation in what Jesus has done for you instead of personal merit. So put your faith in Jesus now, and you're promised by God you're going to go to heaven, and it's irrevocable and irreversible. So you can be confident you're going to go to heaven if you just put your faith entirely in Jesus now. Bless you in the name of our great Savior God, Jesus Christ.